thanks very much for coming to this important celebratory event. It seems to be worth reminding ourselves of what we're celebrating. First of all, as I counted the 70th birthday of a great American, Martin Luther King Jr. And therefore, the less perhaps long and perhaps not quite as well established over that whole 7 years as it has been since 1968, a dream that I think is properly an American dream, but which has not been dreamed by enough Americans. This event is an effort, I think, on our part to revitalize the dream for our own purposes. And it's worth reporting that on Friday of last week, this college imagined for itself a newly articulated vision, a central part of which was a renewed pledge to make sure that this campus, as time passes, is increasingly reflective of the realization of the dream that the great figure whose birthday we celebrate today once articulated so movingly. I don't know whether we'll have the opportunity to do today what was done early this morning for more than 2,000 people in downtown Minneapolis, namely to actually hear that voice once again, 30 years later, articulate as it did then, that dream. To hear that, one cannot but be moved. The movement is, I think, generally in the direction of hope, but it is also, in some measure, in the direction of embarrassment, because that great and ringing proposition is, in fact, an appropriate articulation of what should have been, for all of these years, the American dream, and should be by now, but is not yet, an American reality. The college is a grateful host of this event, and there are many here who could have been elsewhere. The Excelsior group, for example, I'm sure is in about as heavy a demand as it ever experiences in a year's time. And here it is, at Augsburg College, on this wonderful afternoon. Thanks for coming. Thanks to you all for coming.
Now I would like to introduce Ryan Mills. Ryan Mills is Vice President of Student Governance, and he is a junior here at Augsburg College, double major, political science and religion. So he will do the welcome on behalf of the student body.
Good afternoon. On behalf of the students of Augsburg College, my pleasure to welcome all of you to the annual Martin Luther King Jr. Convocation. I'm especially pleased to welcome visitors to campus and those from the larger Augsburg community. In his 1963 letter from the Birmingham jail, Dr. King penned some observations that relate well, I think, to what we're doing here today. In the letter he wrote, and I quote, "I am cognizant of the interrelatedness of all communities and states. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly." Here today, I think we are celebrating that interrelatedness that Dr. King recognized and continuing the struggle together, affirming that we do indeed share one single garment of destiny. So again, on behalf of the students of Augsburg College, welcome. Hope you find this to be both an enjoyable and meaningful experience. Thanks.
Now we're going to do the words for the occasion, and it's "The Heart of Diversity" by Keith Allen. It's gospel music.
And it's the rhythm of our hearts.
And it's good for your soul.
We want you to leave here spirit-filled and whole.
It doesn't matter the color of your skin.
Or the character of you within.
The caring, the sharing, the togetherness.
We must come together in
our
culture, not separated by race.
And yes, we do need to spend time just with our own kind.
You mine.
But that's why we have commercials.
Which gives us energy when we turn to the show of life.
It's about diversity.
And celebrating our differences.
And our likenesses.
And?
Becoming emotionally, physically, spiritually stronger.
Together.
When you learn who you are and learn your own culture, you feel good.
In fact, it's an astronomical feeling.
So, check this out.
Don't be content with just knowing who you are. Learn my culture.
Learn his culture.
Learn her culture.
It's true. The more you know, the more you grow.
Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, and I quote, in a real sense, all life is interrelated.
The equity of the poor impoverishes the rich. The betterment of the poor enriches the rich.
We're inevitably our brother's and sister's keeper because we are our brother's brother.
And our sister's sister.
Now you know she had to add that for the 90s. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly.
I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be.
And you can never be what you ought to be until I am what I ought to be.
This is the interrelated structure of reality.
End of quote.
We leave you with this. Race separates us. Culture brings us together. Let the rhythms of our hearts bring us and keep us together. This year's Smart Music Makers is the Excelsior Choral Ensemble. Excelsior was established in 1978, and their current album is entitled Same Mind, Same Purpose, and it is dedicated to Imanita Hawthorne. Now I would like to introduce Excelsior Choral Ensemble.
Thank you. breakfast sponsored by General Mills and the United MLK College Fund, and then we went to the Governor's Commission on Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday. So we just want to tell you that you're doing a great job, okay? Here we go, down by the riverside, the 90s version of this song. All right. That's a man. Come on.
and you want to hear good news. So if you can repeat to me in Jema, can you say that?
Yeah.
Which means good. I just came from the St. Paul celebration of the March. And their theme was unity, the key, the peace and harmony. And I think that's appropriate for what we're here about. Because unless we have unity, we have nothing. I was trying to think of stories to tell today. I was here, Mary Laurel True invited me here to tell stories to the children from the Hiawatha Blaisdell Y and the Boys Club, Boys and Girls Clubs. And whenever I have opportunity to come and tell stories, I do it because a lot of times, a lot of the things we do can be reflected in the stories that we tell. And I was thinking about unity and what is the cause of disunity. Disunity occurs out of our petty jealousies. As our world gets smaller and smaller, more people put more demands to the society. And usually what happens is when someone thinks another person is getting something that they traditionally thought that they should be getting, now we have those Asians who need things. And now we have those blacks that need things. And now the Indians need things. And now the whites need things. And everybody is always saying, we don't have enough. And when we don't have enough, or we think we don't have enough, because we have enough. When we don't think we have enough, we start doing things to break that unity. We start doing things that show our petty jealousies. So I've been struggling with that, and I kept struggling with that until I ran into a storyteller friend of mine from North Carolina. His name is Granddad Papa Jumba. And Granddad Papa Jumba and I was talking about disunity and jealousy, and I said, well, how do you get over disunity? How do you get over jealousy? And he sort of looked at me and he paused for a moment and he says, well, Brother Blue, you can get over jealousy if you start acting like a mule. I said, acting like a mule? What do you mean, acting like a mule? He says, you have to realize the nature of a mule. You see, a mule don't like anything on its back. And if anything gets on its back, the first thing it's going to do is start to shake it off and stomp it down and rise to a higher level. So, can you hear where I'm coming from? You all have to start acting like the mules and do what? Shake it off, stomp it down, and rise to a higher level. Now, I didn't hear you. Let me hear you say that. Shake it off, stomp it down, and rise to a higher level. But if I just say that, that doesn't mean anything, so I have to tell you a story. And it goes like this. There was a jealous farmer that acted like a fool. He was jealous of everything, even his next door neighbor's prized mule. Now, he was so jealous of the dang mule that he said, you know, if I can't have that mule, then I'm going to bury it alive. So he went out to his shed, he got himself a shovel, and he started to dig a hole. And boy, did he go to work. He started digging it kind of long. And then when it was long enough, he said, not wide enough. So he started to dig it kind of wide. And when it was wide enough, he says, it's not deep enough. That mule would just get out of it. So he started to dig it deeper and deeper and deeper until it was as high as a man. And he said, that's where that mule is going to sleep. But you know, he had to trick that mule to get into that hole because the mule wasn't going to walk in it by himself. So he started to get them oats because he said, mules, they like oats. And he started to lay the oats from the hole to where that mule was fast asleep. Well, you know how it is when you get up in the morning, you're kind of hungry, and so was that mule. So when he looked at the oats, the way he looked at them, you would have thought, That was the last meal that he was going to eat. Because he started eating it. He started going, yum, yum, yum. Yum, yum, yum. Yum, yum, yum. He kept eating the oats until he fell into the hole. Well, when he fell into the hole, he made such a commotion that that farmer said, I got him. And I'm going to bury him alive. So he ran out and he got his shovel and started doing that evil thing. He commenced to throw in that dirt on that mule's backside. Well, he wasn't a mule man. Because had he been a mule man, he would have realized that mules simply don't like anything on their back. Because when the dirt hit the mule, y'all know what the mule did. He just started to shake it off, stomp it down, and rise to the level. Farmer still didn't see it. He said, I'm going to bury that mule. I'm going to bury him alive. So he started to shovel a little faster and a little faster. But each time the dirt hit the mule, what did the mule do? Shake it off, stomp it down, and rise to a high level. Farmer still didn't see it. He was thinking about that evil deed. So he started to shovel a little faster and a little faster. Man, he started shoveling so fast, his shovel caught on fire. So you can imagine his shovel caught on fire, so he just padded off that fire and continued to do that evil thing. But each time the dirt hit the mule, what did the mule do? Shake it off, stomp it down, and rise to a high level. Some people say, to this very day, he would have probably still been throwing that dirt upon that mule had he not turned around and looked. Because you see, had he turned around and looked, he would have seen that from all that shaking it off, stomping it down, and rising to a higher level, that mule was clear on level land. So when he went to throw that dirt upon that mule the last time, mule did what any old mule had to do. He just reared back and drop-kicked that farmer clear into next week. So I tell you that story because in your life as you travel around, there's going to be those people that throw the dirt upon your back. Those people who say, you're not the right color. Those people that say, you're too small, you can't do what you need to do. Those people that seek to destroy unity. Don't get upset with them. You don't become foolish. Just start acting like a mule and just shake it off. Stomp it down and rise to a higher level. And be the best possible person you possibly can be, because that's the only thing that your Lord and God want you to be. So, as you travel through life and you get those misfortunes, just remember the story that Brother Bloom told you today and act like a mule and just shake it off, stomp it down, and rise to a higher level.
We do so pledge.
Do
you finally pledge to use your gifts and talents to serve humanity.
We do so pledge.
Thank you.
Pledge sheets will be on the way out or later in the program, and telling us how you'd like to do that, how you can start today, how you've already pledged to do it. Thank you.
Service. care about their college and who writes poems for his hobby. So now we would like to hear what he's got.
Afternoon, everybody.
Afternoon.
Everybody get your spirit here?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll be reading two pieces. The first piece I will be reading is entitled Black I Am. Black I Am. Black to all I do. The way I walk, the way I talk. Black I Am. Respect. Respect for my color. Respect for yours. Respect for my brothers and sisters, even when they do not respect themselves. Black I Am. Not for the color of my skin alone. Because not everyone is black. Black I am by the state of mind I possess, and for the love of my people. Never disrespect by calling me bitter, nor allow myself to be called that. To be true black is to be proud of your heritage, to realize what your ancestors did, to give you the respect that you get now. I may be light-skinned and have big curly hair, but that does not make me any less black. Not to me, nor to America. Because my hair is straight does not make it better than the tattered curls of my dark skinned brothers. Black I am. The power to prove nothing to you makes me black. The power to forgive makes me black. The power to love my people makes me black. The power to love one, my own blessing one, makes me black. Because black I love.
Turn it to Mary Laura True in her office. Her box number is on here. Or she's sitting here.
excitement by Martin Luther King. Please give him a huge hand.
Thank you. Trina says no. Y'all know that she actually runs parent student services and parent student union. Ain't that right? She tells us. I just want to thank both Trina and Neil for their leadership and their support and their direction and their ambition. I definitely have to thank my brother Bobby Champion, who you guys see him up here dancing and directing and singing and leading. And you may not know, particularly some of the children, that he works for the state attorney's office. So he has a real job that pays him money, but he also has a job for the Lord that pays his soul. And so we just want to thank him for at least the past 8 years, or since we've been doing this, Excelsior has come out and been labeled the modern music maker, so we definitely got to give it up to him.
Sunshine, even on a cold day. You want to be first? You want to be great? You want to be important? You want to be significant? Well, you ought to be! If you're going to be my disciple, you must be. He reordered priorities. He said, yes, don't give up this instinct. It's a good instinct if you use it right.
Yes.
It's a good instinct if you don't distort it and pervert it. Don't give it up. Keep feeling the need for being important. Keep feeling the need for being first. And I want you to be first in love. I want you to be first in moral excellence. I want you to be first in generosity. That is what I want you to do. And he transformed the situation by giving a new definition of greatness. And you know how he said it? He said, now, brethren, I can't give you greatness. And really, I can't make you first. This is what Jesus said to James and John. You must earn it. True greatness comes not by favoritism, but by fitness. And the right hand and the left are not mine to give. They belong to those who are prepared. And so Jesus gave us a new norm of greatness. If you want to be important, wonderful. If you want to be recognized, wonderful. If you want to be great, wonderful. But recognize that he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. That's a new definition of greatness. This morning, the thing that I like about it, by giving that definition of greatness, it means that everybody can be great. Because everybody can serve. Every now and then, I guess we all think realistically about that day when we will be victimized with what is life's final common denominator. That's something we call death. We all think about it, and every now and then I think about my own death, and I think about my own funeral, and I don't think of it in a morbid sense. Every now and then I ask myself, what is it that I would want to say? And I leave the word to you this morning. If any of you are around, when I have to meet my day, I don't want a long funeral. And if you get somebody to deliver the eulogy, tell them not to talk to me. And every now and then I wonder what I want to say. Tell them not to mention that I have a Nobel Peace Prize. That isn't. Tell them not to mention that I have 300 or 400 other awards. That's not important. Tell them not to mention where I went to school. I'd like somebody to mention that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to give his life serving others. I'd like for somebody to say that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to love somebody. I want you to say that day that I tried to be right on the walls. I want you to be able to say that day that I did try to feed the hungry. I want you to be able to say that day that I did try in my life to clothe those who were naked. I want you to say on that day that I did try in my life to visit those who were in prison. I want you to say that I tried to love and serve humanity. Yes, if you want to say that I was a drum major. Say that I was a drum major for justice. Say that I was a drum major for peace. I was a drum major the world once more if I can spread the message as a master poet. Then my living will not be in vain. Yes, Jesus, I want to be on the right and the left side. Not for any selfish reason. I want to be on your right, on your left side, not in terms of some political kingdom or ambition. And I just want to be there in love and in justice and in truth.
So it's only appropriate. And there's a little chorus that just says, happy birthday to you. And you'll catch up, okay? Here we go. Happy birthday.